Hello, Bio 400 people. This is Ms. Bogosian, and this is our first screencast of the year. So this is going to be about cycles in biology. So here are some tips to keep in mind about watching a screencast. So usually I'm going to use screencasts instead of lectures for this class, and I'm going to use them to deliver the really dense material. So even though the screencasts are about 10 minutes long usually, it's going to take you about 30 minutes of work because you're going to be taking notes, stopping and starting, and making sure that you record things about the screencast. You're going to want to keep all of your notes in the same place, and you're going to want to bring those to class with you. So it's up to you whether you want to do it in a notebook or whether you want to do it on your iPad, but you're going to need to bring those to class with you. And the screencasts are also really great to re-watch when you don't understand something the first time. You can back up the screencast and re-watch that segment, and you can also re-watch all of your screencasts from the unit to help you review when it comes time to take a test. Okay, so now on to cycles in biology. So there are quite a few of them, and some of the most commonly discussed ones are the carbon cycle, the oxygen cycle, the nitrogen cycle, the phosphorus cycle, and the water cycle. Something to remember about cycles is that the overall amount of substance doesn't increase or decrease. You're simply changing its form or changing its position. So here's a classic example that you probably learned about in middle school, which is the water cycle. Now, because this is a cycle, I could start anywhere, but let's start up here with the cloud. So we have precipitation, so the cloud drops water as rain or snow. The water then either becomes runoff into the ocean or in low-lying areas. It goes into the ground and becomes groundwater. Then we have evaporation, when the water gets really warm, and condensation into a cloud, and then the cycle starts all over again. But we're not using or losing any more water than we started out with. So when we talk about any of these cycles in this list, we're not going to be losing any nitrogen at the end of the cycle than we started out with. We're not going to be losing any phosphorus, we're not going to be losing any of the other biomolecules. So there are a few different atoms that you're probably familiar with from chemistry that are going to be really crucial in biology, and those are going to be carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. And so all of those different atoms are going to combine in different ways to form large molecules, which we call biomolecules, carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids. A lot of these molecules also form nutrients, so we see a lot of nitrogen in the atmosphere. We also see carbon being recycled from one form to another, and we're going to talk about that in the screencast. So to start off our discussion of cycles, it's important to remember that organisms are influencers on their environment, and they are also influenced by their environment. So here's what I mean by that. So if I look at the really easy example of a tree, it's going to be influenced by its environment in a few ways. So it's going to take in water from the ground, it's going to take in carbon dioxide from the environment around it, and it's going to absorb photons of light from the sun. The tree also influences its environment in turn because it provides things like oxygen, which is a byproduct of photosynthesis. It also does things like provide habitats for other organisms, it provides shade, and it also might even provide a building area for other organisms like vines. So none of the organisms exist in isolation. They all depend on one another. And we're going to take a look at that in a little bit more detail now. We're going to segue into something called the nutrient cycle. Now, when I refer to nutrients, I'm talking about some of those biomolecules that we discussed earlier, especially something like nitrogen or phosphorus. No matter how healthy the tree is, ultimately it's going to either die or fall over in some kind of storm and wind up on the forest floor. Because this tree used to be alive and is composed of organic matter, it's full of tons and tons of nutrients, which are now trapped inside the dead tree. Given some time, however, this tree is ultimately going to become a habitat for things like lichen and moss and other things like fungi. These organisms are collectively known as decomposers, and they will break down the old trunk of the tree and start releasing the nutrients back into the environment. Soil or dirt is made up of many different ingredients, but one of the most important is called humus, which is decomposed organic matter. And ultimately, the organic matter from the dead tree will become part of the soil in the general area. The soil will be full of many of the nutrients that were originally held inside the tree when it was alive. That soil will become extremely nutritious and will allow more organisms to grow and will also nourish the plants that are still in the area that are alive. So in this way, we've gone from a living tree to a dead tree, to a dead tree with fungus growing on it, to soil, and then returned all of the nutrients back to the environment. We haven't lost any of them. So this is a pretty straightforward nutrient cycle, but we're going to zoom out a little bit and think about one that's a little bit more realistic. So when you were younger, you probably learned about the food chain in middle or elementary school, and it starts off with creatures called producers. Depending on whether you're looking at a land or a marine environment, these are going to include plants and or algae, but the thing that they have in common is that they're all photosynthetic organisms that get their energy from the sun. The next step is going to be primary consumers, and these are going to be herbivores, so creatures that live on plants or on algae. So on land, this might be something like a mouse or a rabbit, and in the ocean, you might have something like zooplankton or animal plankton. Secondary consumers are going to prey upon primary consumers, and so indirectly, they also depend on the presence of producers as well. Finally, at the so-called top of the food chain, you have something called tertiary consumers, and they depend on the presence of all of the other organisms that are below them in the food pyramid. We tend to think of the nutrients as flowing from producers to primary to secondary to tertiary consumers, and then to decomposers. This is accurate. The decomposers will break down the organic matter from each of these different kinds of organisms, and then will return the nutrients to the soil, which allows the nutrients to re-enter the cycle at the producer stage. However, the cycle can also be slightly more complex, because decomposers can also break down dead producers, dead primary consumers, and dead secondary consumers to allow their nutrients to re-enter the nutrient cycle. We should also think about the energy flow that occurs in most ecosystems. With very few exceptions, such as at deep sea ocean vents, the energy in most ecosystems comes originally from the sun. The sun emits particles called photons of light, which allow producers to undergo a process called photosynthesis, where they use energy from the sun, as well as a couple of different kinds of biomolecules, in order to generate their own food. When primary, secondary, and tertiary consumers eat organisms from the level below them, we have energy flow that flows from the lower organisms to the higher organisms. However, it's not a perfect system. You don't have nearly as many tertiary consumers as you have primary consumers. Here's why. In biology, there isn't a perfect transfer of energy from one organism to another. It follows something called the 10% rule. If, for instance, you have 100,000 units of producers, whether that's 100,000 kilograms of them, 100,000 calories worth of producers, or just 100,000 organisms, it can only support 10% as many primary consumers. So in our example, 100,000 organisms of producers could only support about 10,000 rabbits. 10,000 rabbits could only support about 1,000 secondary consumers. And about 1,000 secondary consumers can support roughly 100 tertiary consumers. So now our question has to become, what happens to all of that extra energy that's not accounted for here? So most of the energy that's lost between one trophic level, like producers right here, and the next level up, like primary consumers, is lost because we have to run the animal's metabolic processes. The rest of it is actually lost via heat. So a lot of these are endotherms, and so they release a lot of heat. They're not very efficient, and that's where a lot of that extra energy goes. That pretty much wraps it up. See you all in class.